Don't be confused. This is not a video on solar panels. You clicked on the right thumbnail. But solar panels are a marvel, right? One of the neatest things about them is that they can be used almost anywhere, from big farms to residential spaces and anything in between. If only we could make other renewables, like wind power, just as versatile. Well, that's exactly what a company called Heirloom Energy is trying to do. They claim they've developed a radically different kind of wind energy device, one that's much cheaper, more flexible, and has the backing of Bill Gates. Given his clean tech investing success rate, I'll let you decide if that's a badge of honor or a sign that this device is all hot air. How does Heirloom work, and is their radically different wind turbine design going to change the game? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. This video is brought to you by Incogni, but more on that later. Have you ever loved a really bad B-movie? Like, it's one of your favorite movies ever, but you recognize that it's got serious flaws, or that all your friends hate it? I've got quite a few of those on my list. Now, I'm not saying what Heirloom is doing is on that level at all, but as drawn as I am to what Heirloom is doing, there are a lot of open questions to their approach. Before getting into those questions, what are they doing in the first place? Well, inspired by his time windsurfing, Heirloom Energy founder Robert Lumley began sketching out this novel wind energy generator almost a decade ago. The result is a wind power device that looks more like a clothesline or a kinetic sculpture than the turbines that you're used to seeing across the country. But how does it work? Well, a cable runs in a track on top of a series of 25 meter or 82 foot tall poles arranged in an oval. Now, put a pin in that oval idea for later. Anyway, the vertically oriented 10 meter or 33 foot tall blades are attached to the cable. They intercept the wind as it travels down both the home and the back stretch of the cable's track. The blades move around the track, generating torque, which is then translated into energy and sent to the grid. You know the drill. Now, an 82 by 33 foot track sounds massive, but it's small compared to a standard horizontal axis wind turbine. Most horizontal axis wind turbines operating at the moment are taller than the Eiffel Tower, and China just launched an offshore turbine 50 stories tall. Why so big? Well, simply put, bigger blades capture more energy, and taller towers allow for bigger blades. Plus, they elevate the blades up to where the air currents are strong and consistent, which is very important for energy production. However, the Heirloom device sidesteps those big parts. It's long, low to the ground, and transportable. They also claim that the device is modular, with the length and height of the track being customizable. These features should allow their device to be deployed to places where bigger turbines just can't fit. Now, that said, the most exciting part of the Heirloom device is the alleged cost savings. Now, large turbines are expensive to manufacture, ship, install, and maintain, making for a large levelized cost of energy, or LCOE. Now, that's a calculation of an energy producer's lifetime costs measured against how much juice it makes. I'm not talking about orange juice here. Now, if the Heirloom device works as promised, it could radically lower wind energy's high LCOE costs, maybe by as much as 66%. For reference, the current LCOE on a wind farm is about 4 cents per kilowatt hour. Heirloom claims that they can do it for just over a penny. Of course, that's a pretty big if, accompanied by some too good to be true sounding numbers. So how does this relatively small device make as much energy as a horizontal axis wind turbine? With a little bit of airbending trickery. By running their airfoils in that oval rather than a circle, Heirloom claims that they alter the math behind swept area. And that's the area that the blades of a turbine sweep through as they extract energy from the air. As we mentioned earlier, the bigger the area, the more efficient the turbine. However, that necessitates bigger turbines and bigger blades, which limits where the turbines can be deployed. Heirloom's swept area is a function of track length as opposed to the radius of a horizontal axis wind turbine's blades. Where your average horizontal wind axis turbine gets maximum torque from the fast-moving tips of its blades, but not much from the bits closest to the hub, the full length of each of Heirloom system's blades contribute to hauling the whole loop around. Essentially, instead of a few large blades on a vertical structure, that energy capture potential is distributed across many smaller blades, moving horizontally, or at least Heirloom claims. It's neat, but has it been tested? Does it actually work? Well, the answer is a very, very tentative yes. Heirloom has a 50 kilowatt testing device set up in Wyoming, and though testing has just begun, everything seems to be going according to plan. Heirloom just secured $4 million in seed funding, spearheaded by Breakthrough Energy Ventures. With the early tests going well, they're preparing to move forward with a 1 megawatt prototype, with plans to eventually scale up to a 2.5 megawatt real deal. But at least at the time of writing this video, I can't find any evidence or even claims that third-party tests have been conducted, which certainly is a reason to raise an eyebrow. Now, we'll return to this lack of outside assessment in a moment, but first, theoretically, let's assume Heirloom really has cracked the code and made a wind energy device as powerful as a horizontal axis wind turbine for a fraction of the initial cost and LCOE. How are they doing this, and why use it over a regular turbine? Well, speaking of harnessing powerful forces and putting it to good use, there's another powerful force that you can put to protect your online privacy, and that's today's sponsor, Incogni. Now, I've mentioned this before, but I signed up for a newsletter from a small online retailer, and after I did, I saw a major increase in the number of promotional emails I was receiving from companies I'd never heard of. That happened because that company sold my information to a data broker. Sometimes they sell your info to some pretty shady people, or they can fall victim to data breaches that leak your data to scammers. Now, I'm sure you've experienced it too. Incogni can help you with this. We have the right to request the data brokers delete our information, but it takes a lot of time and effort. I signed up for Incogni, gave them the legal right to work on my behalf, and then just sat back and relaxed. You'll see updates on your account for which data brokers they've sent legal requests to and which ones have complied. Couldn't be easier. I've been letting Incogni stay on top of this for me for quite a while now, and I'm really happy with the results. If you want to take back some of the control around who has access to your personal information, give Incogni a try. The first 100 people to use the code UNDECIDED at the link below will get 60% off Incogni. Thanks to Incogni and to all of you for supporting the channel. So back to why you may want to use Heirloom over a regular turbine. Well, Heirloom proposes using readily sourced materials and parts to make sure there's minimal supply chain, shipping, or manufacturing headaches. These parts are small and are made from widely available materials, so they can be manufactured in non-specialist factories. You're talking about small airfoils, metal structures and tracks, versus aircraft carrier-sized wind turbine blades. And combine that with their device's relatively small size, and they claim manufacturing their device will cost just 10% of an equivalent horizontal axis wind turbine's price tag. Then there's the shipping costs, and this one is a big one. The sheer size of wind turbine blades mean it can be a logistical nightmare to physically ship them, usually from China, to their final destinations. Plus, it's very expensive to ship heavy things like, you know, giant carbon fiber blades and steel pylons. And goofy as it might seem, tight turns, tunnels, and bridges can all become huge turbine transit problems. It can take over a year of planning and 10 separate loads to move just one turbine into place. Meanwhile, Heirloom can fit an entire 2.5 megawatt track inside a standard tractor trailer. The smaller modular size has other alleged benefits too. We mentioned previously how the device can be adjusted in both length and height to fit a larger variety of sites, including places where traditional turbines just can't go. While we usually mean places where other turbines physically can't be deployed, it might also allow us to build wind energy generators in places they aesthetically can't be deployed either. A lot of wind projects get canceled because people really don't want big turbines in their line of sight. For example, New Jersey just lost two offshore wind farms because residents didn't want the turbines to ruin their beachy views. And they're far from the only example, despite wind energy's broad support and approval ratings. People hate having them in their backyard. But the smaller, shorter profile should make Heirloom's device, how do I say this politely, NIMBY resistant. And while we're talking about offshore wind, Heirloom claims that the device works great for both on and offshore purposes. Though again, they haven't presented any information about what that might look like. How much more feasible is it to build a long wind track instead of a single platform? I have questions. Back to cost savings though. Taking into account the cheaper materials, manufacturing, shipping, and installation, Heirloom calculates that its wind farms can be built for less than 25% of the cost to build a conventional wind project, just 21 cents per watt, compared to the standard $1.25 per watt. Add in the lower maintenance costs, and you can start to see why Heirloom's projected LCOE is so low. Now, LCOE varies from site to site, but with an LCOE at just over a penny per kilowatt hour, by some accounts, wind could surpass solar as the cheapest form of energy generation. Now, this is the point where we have to get real. Now, call me cynical, but the lack of third-party testing is a stark and serious red flag for right now. Heirloom has only recently come out of stealth mode, so it's possible these tests are on the way. I would assume they are, but however, until some national labs have vetted their work and some economists who know their way around green tech have given this a thumbs up, we just really won't know how well it works or how cost-effective it will be in the real world, and that's a bigger deal. And I hate to say it, but historically speaking, there's good reason to be critical of Heirloom's device. They're not the only group to try to revolutionize the wind energy sector with smaller or cheaper devices. There's Shearwind Envelox, Saffon Energy, TransPower, and many, many others. Now, all these options looked good on paper, more or less, but so far none have proved to be viable. Disconcertingly, TransPower's device looks an awful lot like heirlooms, and they fell apart in the 1980s. But that may have fallen apart because the time wasn't right, and the technology is here now to make it viable. Gonna have to wait and see on that one. But there's also some conventional wind engineering wisdom reasons to doubt heirlooms' design. As we touched on earlier, there's a lot of reasons turbines have been getting taller. Tall masts and big blades give you a certain kind of efficiency and consistency that anything lower to the ground is going to struggle to match. Turbulence is a major issue for wind turbines too, especially small turbines, since it can reduce a turbine's annual energy output by 15 to 25%. So how do you get away from that turbulence? Unfortunately for small and low-lying turbines, you go above it. The general rule of thumb is to install a wind turbine on a tower with the bottom of the rotor blades at least 30 feet or 9 meters above an obstacle that's within a 300 foot or 90 meter radius of the tower. So even if heirloom can truly make radically cheaper turbines, it won't matter if the turbines aren't able to consistently and effectively generate energy due to weak winds or turbulence. I haven't even touched on some of the questions that came up with my team around things like dirt buildup and friction with the track system over time. How will that impact performance? There's so many open questions. To be fair, heirloom is in the early stages, so third-party tests are likely to come. And with the backing of Gates and the promising round of seed funding, heirloom has a solid financial base that might help them navigate some of the upcoming challenges. They say that they're going to be building a pilot project in 2025, with plans to build a commercial demonstration connected to the grid by 2026 or 2027. So we shouldn't have to wait very long to find out if their device actually works or not. Now, despite some of my skepticism, innovation does happen, and maybe heirloom really does have the magic formula for cheaper, better wind power. At the same time, the sector is also littered with devices that sounded good on paper, but just couldn't work in the field for whatever reason. Often a device passes every test and almost makes the leap to commercialization, only for some small detail to ultimately prove that it's just not economically viable. As a science and technology communicator, I have a Carl Sagan quote quota that I have got to meet. So here it goes. Extraordinary claims require extraordinary evidence. And a device that could transform the energy sector? That's definitely extraordinary. So I'll be watching heirloom closely. Now, fingers crossed that they live up to the hype. But what do you think? Is heirloom onto something, or is it just hype? Jump in the comments and let me know. And be sure to check out my follow-up podcast, Still to be Determined, where I'll be discussing some of your feedback. And thanks to all my patrons who get ad-free versions of every video. Your support really does help to keep delivering you these videos every single week. If you'd like to support the channel and get in on the early videos, check out the link in the description. I'll see you in the next one.